check thing. Alrighty. Okay. Welcome everyone, my name is Inter. I am back with part 6 of the Oxygen Unincluded series, Surviving in the Badlands, where I am playing a colony on the Badlands asteroid type. In today's episode, we're going to be looking at the steam rocket, and especially the automation that goes with the steam rocket, but also some other automation things I've done around the base. And before I dive into game, I just want to go through my agenda today of what we're going to be talking about. Last time I mentioned the F4 key for finding volcanoes and geysers and vents and all that thing, but I forgot to actually demonstrate it, so let me begin with that right now before I forget again. Here in game, there are, as you know, there are a number of geysers and volcanoes and stuff that are hidden around the map, and they can usually be found by going to the thermal overlay and looking for these 4 tile wide blocks of neutronium, because every volcano or geyser event has a block of neutronium beneath it, and the neutronium shows up as blue on the thermal overlay. So you can find things down in here. So there must be something there, there's something there, and there's something there, and there are 2 or 3 more above that I have yet to dig up. And this is how I have been looking for them up until present. But I started going into the F4 overlay, which is the materials overlay, and I started going through the different settings here, and I realized one of the much easier ways to find volcanoes and such is to use the cultivatable soil overlay. And the reason for this is because every one of these volcanoes and stuff have a single tile of dirt adjacent to them. To the right side of the neutronium, there's a single tile of dirt. And these little dirt footprints on the F4 materials overlay, cultivatable soil, kind of stand out like a sore thumb when you go out to the much larger picture. And I know it might be difficult to see the color here on YouTube, but if you're actually playing this on a desktop and you have the full screen in front of you, it becomes much easier to see these little tiny single blocks of orange-brown color. They really pop out, and there's nothing else around them contrasting with them. It's just a bunch of gray with some dirt blocks next to them. Now, in some cases, currently on this playthrough, I've already dug out the dirt block, so there used to be a dirt block right here next to the slush geyser, but I've dug it out and replaced it with an insulated tile. Same thing with a couple of the other things around here. Like both of my steam vents, of course, have completely drained away, so there's nothing next to them. But it's very easy to find brand new volcanoes this way, just by using the F4 cultivatable soil overlay. They really pop out. So just wanted to give that to you guys as a little piece of advice. So I can see there's one over here, there's one here, there's the gold volcano, or what's left of the gold volcano. I never swept it. There's one right here, there's one right here. And this is just a much easier way to see things than trying to find blocks of neutronium in a blue background. So I think that's a much easier way of doing things. So there we go, that's that piece of advice out of the way. Let's see, in the last stream I was worried about the automation with the hydrogen generators, but I'm going to save talking about that until we actually look at the hydrogen generators. Sedimentary rock. Okay, so if you've been following the series, then this will not come as a surprise, but if you just happen to be tuning into episode 6 of the series as your first foray into the adventure, then you may not be aware that the Badlands asteroid type, which is what we're playing on right now, does not come with the swamp biomes, or as I call them, the warm slime biomes. So there's no slime, there's no gold amalgam, there's no huge pools of algae and polluted water and paku fish and everything else. And along with that, there is also no sedimentary rock that you can dig up anywhere on the map. However, if you've been paying very careful attention to my resources overlay in past streams, you may have seen that I do actually have a fair bit of sedimentary rock at this point. This was not dug up from anywhere on the map. I actually manufactured this in some way that I really hadn't paid attention to until recently. I was like, where the heck is all this stuff coming from? Turns out it's coming from the rock crusher, and specifically when I turn fossil into lime. The major byproduct of that is sedimentary rock. You just get a little bit of lime back, but the vast majority of the fossil material gets converted into sedimentary rock. So that's where it's all been coming from. I have produced 15.6 tons of sedimentary rock by processing nearly 15 tons, or excuse me, processing more than 15 tons of fossils. And these all came from the worm or the oil biome, which is where we are right now. So, fossils. Fossils. Lots of fossil. There's fossil everywhere down here. So all the stuff that I've dug up, all the space that I've cleared, that is where the fossil came from that got converted into sedimentary rock. In case you were wondering. Alright, and while I'm down here looking at the oil biome, I decided to actually start using the natural gas geyser. If you've been watching previous episodes, then you probably noticed that in between the cool slush geyser and one of the cool steam vents that I've been using, there was also a natural gas geyser over here, spitting out lots and lots of natural gas. And last episode, this thing was still entombed. I still had it encased in rock. I was not using it yet. But I decided I might as well start tapping into it so I can use the supposedly infinite amount of natural gas that is in here to start powering natural gas generators and doing other kinds of things. And especially to make sure that I can actually use the gas range. Now, I got lucky in this instance to have a natural gas geyser on this map. These things are not guaranteed, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time showcasing these or talking about it, but just wanted to let you know in case you're wondering about future episodes. I do intend to actually start using this natural resource to be a source of power in natural gas generators. Oi, where'd you go? Come back. No. Natural gas, there we go. So I intend to start using some natural gas generators to consume that stuff and get free power down here so I don't have to keep sending duplicates down to run on hamster wheels. Alright, and now we're talking about cooling. I will come back to hamster wheels in a few minutes. So, cooling stuff. Passive cooling between the slush geyser and the steam vent. That's actually right where we're looking right now. I decided to take the cold water from the cool slush geyser and put it into contact with the base of the cool steam vent's very hot water and tried to provide some passive heat exchange between the two materials. So the slush water down here is up to 53 degrees, and the geyser water up here is down to 85 degrees. So we're getting pretty good results out of that. And because the pump is right above the heat exchange plate, it is sending out much cooler water than you might find elsewhere in this pool, where it's usually above 90 degrees. So I'm happy with that. Well, if I was using this one right now, it would be sending out some nice, relatively cool 85 degree water. So I'll be using this for a while, and as you can see, I keep excavating more and more space to make room for the infinite polluted water that's coming out of here. I don't really have any plans for the water itself, but I would like to start using this cooling for other things if I can. The only challenge with that is it's kind of far away from anything that I actually want to cool. Like, I want to keep the base cool, and now that I've started getting into rocketry, I'd like to keep some things in rocketry cool. But it's all the way at the other end of the map, and I don't know if I want to go through the trouble of trying to move it. So I'm a little bit reluctant to tap into this, but I keep making space for it until I do. Oh, still on cooling. Passive cooling for the metal refinery coolant. So going back to the base, I have my metal refinery in here, which is taking in some polluted water. Polluted water going into it right now seems to be about 49 degrees, which is a bit cooler than how I found it earlier. It was getting up to about 60 degrees, and the output temperature was right on the verge of boiling the polluted water. It was like 116 degrees Celsius. It was getting way too close for comfort. So I went back to using my cooling loop, but instead of spending energy to actively pump the material through, I have now set up a totally isolated cooling loop, which moves in a very sluggish manner. these isolated passive cooling or passive loops of material, I finally figured out how to do them. They work really well when you only have one bridge, but as you can see, this loop is sort of snaking all over the place and has what, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight bridges. So it is very, very sluggish. The material kind of moves and sits and then moves again and then sits and yeah. But at least it works. I don't have to put any more effort into it. It could just go perpetually at this point. So I'm trying to gradually cool down the reusable metal refinery coolant material by dumping some of its heat into the relatively cooler clean water pool over here. And I've been trying to reinforce the cold of this polluted water. As you can see, I dug out some more space and gave it room to grow. I've been trying to reinforce the coolness in here by exchanging some of the cool water out of here that had come from the cold biome. It's all been melting down into this collection pool point, and I've just been funneling it out back to the base. So, trying to make use of what cooling I can find. And finally, talking about the last piece of cooling. Just a second, please. The nullifier, which has been faithfully maintaining the relatively cool temperatures in my electrolyzer system. It is fighting a losing battle because the water that I am sending into this electrolyzer room is really hot. I think the coolest it's been so far is 72 degrees. It's always been hot water that has been coming into here, feeding into the electrolyzers. And the electrolyzers can only delete so much heat when they convert the water into air. So it's been a losing battle for the nullifier up here to try to cool down the water that's being pumped through it. As you can see, the room is turning into sort of a greenish color as opposed to blue. And even though I have the thermo sensor set to keep the nullifier active if the temperature is above 6 degrees, it's always above whatever temperature I set it to now. It's just constantly fighting, constantly trying to keep the stuff cool and always fighting a losing battle. So, in consequence of that, it is constantly chewing through hydrogen. And the nullifier continuously running in conjunction with the other various hydrogen generators that I have around here. There's the two for the electrolyzer room, of course. There's one over here that's or running the automation for the stables. There is another one down here, which I showed in the last episode, supplying power to the pumps for the water. And now I have hooked up two more into my power grid, which I'll be talking about briefly. So, with all of those sources of consumption for the hydrogen, I am actually starting to quite. I am starting to run out of the hydrogen reserves that I had at a rather uncomfortable rate. Granted, in the space of 100 cycles of playtime, it's only run out of about four reservoirs worth of material, but it's constantly running out. It's never replenishing. So, I'm trying to come up with a solution for that. If push comes to shove, I might tap into the hydrogen vent that I uncovered over here. I might do that. I'm not super inclined to because the temperature comes out here at 500 degrees Celsius, so that would take some effort before I'm even able to start using it. But still, I'm dealing with that however I can. So yeah, things are staying relatively cool down here, but not as cool as they used to be. It used to be blue in these rooms, and now it's gradually reduced itself to green. So, fighting a losing battle. But at the moment, we're doing okay. The base is still staying at pretty decent temperatures, comfortable range of climate in here, so I can't complain. It's doing all right. It's putting out oxygen that is staying in the low 20s or mid 20s. I'm okay with that. All right, and finally, I took my advice from the last stream and rearranged that cooling loop that we were just looking at for the electrolyzers. I said last time that I probably do have room to move these liquid valves from out here into the power plant room, and I decided I do have room. And heat at the moment is no longer an issue, so I just condensed things a bit to save on space. So, no big deal there. And the last update for my base proper is the addition of a massage clinic and the virtual planetarium. So, talk about the massage clinic first. I installed one of those up here. It is sitting at maximum decor pretty much everywhere in the room. It's a lot of decor stuff in here. This is made out of granite. These are made out of granite. This is copper. I could have used gold amalgam because it has a little bit more, but I decided to not waste that precious resource. And mirth leaf, so it's all kinds of happy stuff in here. And I decided to put it on this corner of the base where the pressure is usually reduced by this pump being active. Why is it not active? It should have just been active. No, whatever. Anyway, the pressure is usually low on this corner of the base because of this pump running. But I figured since this room is used so seldomly, it probably won't be a problem to dedicate a low pressure area to something that is hardly ever used. So I think it's okay. And I rearranged some of my machinery around this sector of the base to make room for the installation of a virtual planetarium. So now, at long last, after many, many cycles of waiting, the science lab is complete. We have the research station, the supercomputer, and the virtual planetarium. All three science machines in one. And the reason I installed the virtual planetarium is because I have been to space. I have gone on one trip to space and come back with a customary 60 units of interstellar research, these gold orange bar things. So in addition to the blue and the purple, I now have orange. So now I'm researching orange stuff at the virtual planetarium. So I have been on one rocket trip so far, and I would like to get us up into space before the stream ends. The rocket is about two-thirds filled with steam at the moment. It's at 643 kilograms of steam out of a total capacity of 900, and I don't think we even need the full 900 to get to the closest planet, so I could probably send it sooner than that, and I'll just keep an eye on the star map in order to figure out whether or not we can go too far so far. So nope, I'll just keep hovering my mouse over here to see if we have enough steam to get to that point. Does it actually tell us how much, like, would it tell us how much fuel we need? I don't know. I'll just keep messing with it. Yeah, so most of the rest of this episode is going to be talking about the rocket and how all of that stuff works. Final piece here, rerouted floor wiring to accommodate... nobody cares about that. That's so unimportant, it's not even relevant. Okay, I guess that was the last piece of base change. Finally, I'm going to be talking about automation systems. So before I get into that, let me check on chat, and then we'll dive deep into the automation topic. Mr. Mark is here! Hello, am I? Yeah, I'm streaming more at my usual time, Mark, so apologize for keeping you up late at night. Okay, let's get OBS over to game stream, because I'm going to be trying to actually play the game and run some things at hopefully decent speed. And it would be nice if the game actually runs and can stream slightly smoother. Come on, YouTube. You can see it. Come on. You can see it. No more black screen. We don't need any more black screen. Come on, YouTube. See the game. See the game. Hey, there we go. Come on. You can see it. Okay, cool. So, YouTube is good. All right. For the first piece of automation, let us go to the base and look at the carbon skimmer. I know it's kind of an odd place to start talking, but I was really proud of this last time in the last episode, so I wanted to show a significant improvement that I made to it. And the significant improvement was just the simple addition of this filter gate. So previously, the Atmos sensor, which is looking for pressure in its current tile, was directly connected to the AND gate. So the Atmos sensor was having a direct connection to input A of the AND gate, whereas the two gas element sensors, which are both looking for carbon dioxide, together they were contributing to input B of the AND gate. However, I was finding this entire circuit was turning on a bit too often, and the carbon skimmer was running a bit too often, and causing there to be a big dip in the carbon dioxide. Like, I was seeing oxygen all the way down here to the carbon skimmer, and it was reducing the pressure in my base a little bit too much too quickly. So my solution for this was to introduce a filter gate in between the atmos sensor and input A. What the filter gate does is maintain the output of a red signal for a few seconds after it starts receiving a green input. So for example, if the atmos sensor detects pressure in a range that is above the whatever I set it to here, it's currently registering 1892, so let me just lower it down to something like 1800 just for demonstration's sake. So the atmos sensor says, oh, I am registering a current pressure in my current tile that is above the desired range. Let me send a green signal out. Let me send a green signal out. And this green signal goes into the input of the filter gate. But the filter gate is saying, like, whoa, 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 hold your horses. I see your green signal, but I'm not going to do anything with that green signal until my commensurate 2 seconds, by default it's usually 5 seconds, but in this case I guess I set it for 2 seconds, until my complete 2 seconds has gone by. And you can watch this red outline count down around the filter gate. So I'll unpause the game. There it goes. Boom. Okay. My commensurate, or my required 2 seconds of delay time have elapsed. Now I will convey your green signal from my output to wherever you're trying to send it. So hold your horses, wait 2 seconds, and then I will send a green signal. So the filter gate maintains the output of a red signal until the elapsed time has gone by, or the required time has elapsed. All right. Now, if I remove that green signal, the nice thing about the filter gate is it immediately goes back to sending a red signal. It does not delay. It will delay a green output, but it does not delay a red output. So as soon as I change the sensor back to the actual pressure that I want it to be, which is above its current pressure, and as soon as the red signal is sent from the atmos sensor, the filter gate will immediately transmit the red output. So here we go. Boom, just like that. So that is the behavior of a filter gate. Excuse me. The counterpart to a filter gate is the buffer gate. The buffer gate behaves in a very similar manner, but it does the exact opposite with its outputs. Remember, the filter gate will maintain the output of a red signal for a few seconds after it has started to receive a green signal. That's what the filter gate does. The buffer gate maintains the output of a green signal for a few seconds after it has received a red input. So very similar behavior, just the exact opposite. Filter maintains red output, filter gate maintains red output, buffer gate maintains green output, and both of those do those maintenance for a few seconds after they have received a different input. Now, you can set the delay to be whatever you want to. By default, it is 5 seconds. You can go up to 200 seconds if you want to. You can really just sit here and wait for however many minutes that is. just sit here and wait, looking at this red outline slowly counting down. You can do that if you want to. Don't know why you would, but you can. So you have a lot of range to play with on those delay settings, but they both behave in similar manners. It's just that the filter maintains red and the buffer maintains green outputs until that timer has elapsed. So the function of this, the way this filter gate has improved the carbon skimmer behavior, is it just waits a few moments before it actually activates the carbon skimmer. And by waiting just those brief 2 seconds, I have been able to see a marked reduction in how often the carbon skimmer is turned on. the reason this filter gate and that delay involved with it is so helpful is because the atmos sensor will sense pressure change immediately of any kind of material that passes by it. So for example, if a pocket of polluted oxygen, I'll just draw one with sandbox tools. Let's see, polluted oxygen gas, no food poisoning, low temperature. If I were to have a polluted oxygen thing like that right there, and that tile of polluted oxygen were to shift to the right, where this liquid vent is currently sitting, if we're to move to the right, a lot of the carbon dioxide that is in this tile will be displaced in other directions. Some of it will move to the right, some of it will move down. It'll get out of the way of the polluted oxygen tile when the polluted oxygen moves to the right, if it moves to the right, of course. And when some of that displaced carbon dioxide gets shoved out over here, it will suddenly occupy the atmos sensor's tile, and the atmos sensor will perceive a sudden spike in the pressure on its current location. And by perceiving that spike, it was sending out green signals erroneously. It was sending them out way too often to be necessary. And that is why the carbon skimmer was turning on so often, was because all of these green polluted oxygen tiles that were coming out of my polluted water, they were off-gassing and filling this room with lots of little green tiles. And to be perfectly honest, I'm kind of wondering why I'm not seeing more green tiles at the moment. but it was very frequently passing by the atmos sensor and causing spikes in pressure. So just by having those brief 2 seconds of delay between seeing the green and passing on the green, I was able to prevent the carbon skimmer from turning on erroneously. So it's been a huge, huge help. So that's what that's for. The other piece of automation I added, once again in the form of a filter gate, was to the hydrogen generators that I have added into the power grid. From the end of last episode left off with me worrying about having green and red outputs conflicting on the same connected wire. As it turns out, there was nothing to worry about. In the last episode, I was saying, oh, what will happen? Will the automation wire constantly flicker back and forth between green and red? Will it cause my CPU to crash? Will it cause the game to crash and freeze because it's constantly stuttering and flickering back and forth between two colors? Will the game even know what to do? Well, it turns out I didn't need to worry about anything. It turns out that in almost every case involved in the automation circuitry in this game, a green signal overrides a red signal. In almost every case, a green signal overrides a red signal. So in this case right here, we can see an example. This battery circuit is trying to output... This is a NOT gate. A NOT gate outputs the opposite. So this circuit is correctly outputting a green. My bad. This circuit is correctly outputting a green because of this NOT gate. And most of the other batteries, because they currently have a bit of charge in them, are saying, hey, whoa, we don't need to output a red through our NOT gate because we already have some charge in us. We're all good. So what should be happening is this NOT gate down here, because it has green on its input, its output should be red. But as you can see, it clearly isn't red. And up here, this has green on its input, so the NOT gate should be outputting red, but it's not. And this one up here, it's inputting green, so it should be outputting red, but it's not. So this one NOT gate, which is behaving correctly, is overruling the NOT gate outputs of all of the other five batteries. So just this one NOT gate alone is saying, hey, my green is more important than any of your other people's reds. I need juice. I need power. I need some generators to kick on and start giving me some power. So green trumps red, and that was a nice thing to alleviate my concerns. Now in this case with the filter gate, I have set the filter's delay to be 25 seconds because I actually want duplicants to have time to realize that their services are required at the manual generators and to have time to respond to that requirement and actually commute all the way up here and hop on a generator and start running. Without that significant delay, the generators over here, the two hydrogen generators, were turning on long before the duplicates could arrive at the manual generators, and they were supplying power before anybody could respond. So let's just watch countdown. We're still counting down, still counting down. Has anybody arrived? No, because we're in the middle of a shift change, so everybody's getting ready to go to bed. But oh, here comes somebody. Here comes somebody. In the final seconds of the countdown, people are arriving at the generators. Frankie's getting on. He's going for a spin. Yahoo! Frankie's contributing to the power output. All right, once this counts down. Oh, I guess we'll turn on the generators as well. And I currently have the right one disabled. So the left one is like, yeah, okay, I'll help you out with that power demand. And Frankie and the generator are working together to refill this battery with charge. So the function of the NOT gate serves two purposes in this instance. It gives time for duplicates to respond, so the duplicates can receive the statistics benefit from actually running on the wheels. So machinery and athletics can continue to remain high on active participants like Frankie at the moment. And the other purpose it serves is to reduce the amount of hydrogen that is being consumed by these generators by allowing the duplicates to assist in the power production. It is reducing the need to consume hydrogen in the generators. So that delay is playing a big role for two pretty important things from a base. All right, so that's that. Yeah, that's it for base automation. I don't think I've made any other changes down around here. Nope, I guess we're good. Okay, so let me check our chat again, and then we'll talk about rockets. Discover all rocket stuff. Yes, okay. All right, that is it. Everything else for the rest of the stream is going to be talking about the rocket. Now, in the course of building the rocket and getting ready to launch it, I have spent so much time up here in this biome, or in this part of the map, that a lot of things in my base have kind of fallen by the wayside. My stable production has fallen out of favor. I have frequently run out of water for the electrolyzers, which is not a good thing. I've just kind of let plastics go by the wayside. A lot of things have been put on hold while I've been devoting all of my efforts into preparing the rocket for launch. So, yeah, even though all the automation I'm about to show you has been for the sake of making future rocket launches easier, the act of getting ready for the initial rocket launch has just been a total and complete demand of my time. It's consumed all of my attention to a ridiculous degree. So first of all, before I dive into the automation, let's talk about what we actually have here. We have a couple of generators, coal generators, because I have stupid amounts of coal, and coal is an easy material to transport. It doesn't require any liquid or ventilation pathing. You just have a duplicate carry it up here and deposit it. So it's a very easy portable power source. So have a couple of these set up here to supply the power for the ample power consumptions that are happening around here. There's a lot of stuff. Every single bunker door has a requirement of 120 watts. The gantry requests 1200. The telescope, each of these scanners, everything and its brother wants some power out of the system. And the tepidizer, which is quite important for the current setup I have for producing steam, requires 960 watts. So altogether, that is a lot of power to be demanded from a relatively small number of machines. So that's why I have two generators running two different lines, and both of them are running pretty well into their tolerance ranges. Okay, so that's where power is coming from. The telescope is a required building in order to get access to the star map. You can also see the button up here, and its shortcut key is Z. So that brings up the star map. I've already used the telescope to research five celestial bodies so far, and it seems I'm 59% of the way through researching a sixth. So I've already been doing this quite frequently. Now, the telescope can only be used when it has line of sight to space. Currently has no line of sight because the bunker door is closed, but we can solve that in the near future. All right. And when you build the telescope, it has a requirement for an input of some kind of, or some kind of a gas input, and specifically it wants oxygen inside the telescope. I found that isn't really necessary. You don't actually need to supply it with oxygen because you do not actually need to supply it with oxygen if the duplicates who are coming up here to use it are wearing exosuits, which in my duplicate's case they all are. Every time they come up to this part of the map, waiting for the autosave. Every time they come up to this part of the map, they are wearing exosuits. So there's no need to actually have oxygen in here, but the telescope still requires that it sees some kind of input, so you at least need to cater to that. And if I feel like being generous, I can supply it with oxygen, which it ends up burning quite quickly, even though the duplicates are wearing exosuits, which I find a bit strange. I can provide it with oxygen using the rust deoxygenator that I have down here, which is an identical setup to the room that I have down here, which I showed in one or two streams ago. So identical setup, except the gas filter isn't sitting right here, it is sitting out in space. So here's the gas filter for the deoxidizer, the rust deoxidizer I should say, and it is just venting chlorine and everything else directly out into space where it can just disappear. And the only thing that is coming out of the gas filter is the oxygen. See, it's set to look for oxygen, and the oxygen is going into the telescope. So if I want to be generous and a bit wasteful, I can turn this machine on. I guess I'll do that right now, just so you can see it happening. And the pressure sensor says, oh, hey, we have gas in here. Might as well start pumping. Do-do-do-do-do. And turn the clock off and say, okay, that's enough. And it all comes up here. And there goes the oxygen, and the chlorine just vents out into space. So that is quite a nice little thing to have. All right, so now the telescope is filled with 10 kilograms per however much space is in here. And when a duplicate comes up here, they will vent all of that into space. I should probably have some drywall behind this thing. I feel like I should have some drywall, but whatever. Yeah, the oxygen just all kind of filters or dissipates out into space when somebody comes up here and uses it. It's kind of wasteful, but anyway. So yeah, who's coming up here? Is it? Oh yeah, it's one of my scientists. So my two trained scientists are Frankie and my 12th duplicate, who I named AstroTurf because she's an astronaut and she also works with animals. Surf and Turf. She is one of my many ranchers, so I gave her a custom name. And there she goes, and we can watch the telescope, and the telescope no longer has oxygen. It's still putting some in, and that last pipe should be empty, and there we go. Now it's starting to count down how much oxygen it has. But even if the oxygen goes away, the scientists will just stay in here because they're wearing an exosuit, so they don't really care. So you can see how quickly she's making progress on that. Her science skill is 8, and Frankie's is 15. So they both make pretty good progress on that. So yeah, the telescope is required to get access to the star map. The star map allows you to research celestial bodies. Once you have a celestial body researched, you can launch a rocket to that celestial body, assuming your rocket has all of its requirements met. And those requirements are a fuel tank, which obviously needs to be filled with fuel, and a dedicated astronaut, and an astronaut who's wearing an atmosuit. And I don't currently have cargo bay attached. Well, I guess technically the research module counts as a cargo bay, but it automatically empties itself every time the rocket lands. And resources available, nobody cares, nobody cares, nobody cares. And then the destination, you just select some kind of destination. So my destination is going to be this carbon asteroid once again, but I guess it's saying it's out of reach because I don't have enough fuel in here. So I guess we can start fueling it. We have a gantry, so the duplicate can, or specifically this duplicate, AstroTurf, can walk up here and enter the rocket, which I've named Badlandis, like the shuttle Atlantis, but whatever. And obviously we need to have the bunker doors retract, the gantry retract, and then the rocket can launch. So that's what that's all about. These two things go together, the telescope and the rocket. I have a couple of robot sweepers in here to keep things clear on the ground. And if I was to go for full and total automation, which I'd like to by next episode, if I was to go for fully automated rocket launches, then it would help to have a space scanner that can detect meteor showers to see when it is safe to open doors, and another space scanner that can look for rockets coming in to land and open the bunker doors to prepare for its arrival. So I would like to have both of these things functioning. Unfortunately, they claim that they have absolutely no visibility to space at all. Even when the bunker doors open, everything has been swept away. From their current position, looking out into space, they see all of this solid material, and they just complain terribly. They're like, we can't see anything. It literally says, we are at 2% effective. So, because we are 2% effective, we might detect this rocket coming into land anywhere from 200 seconds until before its arrival to 2 seconds before its arrival. 2 seconds is way too late to start opening bunker doors. So yeah, these space scanners are completely useless right now, but I hope to put them up a bit higher and get them actually becoming useful in future episodes, but for now they're just kind of here for show. They don't actually serve any function at the moment, which is sad. And finally, fueling the rocket is everything to do with this machinery. It is everything to do with the automation. I even have some more automation up here. And if I briefly turn on the automation overlay to scare you folks, it looks like this. Boom. All this automation I have put in here to try to make life easier for me in the future as I continue to fuel rockets for future flights. To be perfectly honest, this is all kind of a waste of time. You don't need anything like this. You can just manually control the tepidizer with a single electrical switch. You say switch on, switch off, switch on, switch off, switch on. You can control it manually and everything will work fine. In fact, you could just turn the tepidizer on and brute force your water boiling and you'll be fine that way too. You don't have to have automation. But because I'm lazy, I took the last 100 cycles. Well, it was more like the last 70 cycles, but anyway, I took a long time getting all of this stuff set up, and I proof-checked it several times. I noticed a few errors that I had to tweak and rearrange and improve upon. But it should all work. It's all at a state where I believe it should be able to be fully automated if I choose to let it. So I'm going to try to show some of that in proof in today. And yeah, since everything's kind of sitting at a static state, everything's kind of at rest right now, I want to walk you through all of the connections. And then once you understand where all the connections are being made and what they all do, I will let the game run and you can see everything in action. And I would like to get the rocket filled in order to do a launch before the end of the stream. And it shouldn't take very long. All right, so one last check on chat before we dive into the automation of the rocketry fueling. Okay, so let's begin with the sensors, because automation requires sensors to know when it should do something, when it should change from one state to another, when it should output a red instead of a green, or when it should output a green instead of a red. Everything is required on receiving some kind of input, and that input comes from these sensors. So I technically have four sensors and a few manual overrides. These clock sensors act as manual overrides because me, myself, the player, can grab the active duration meter and change the output from red to green, or from green to red. I can manually change what is being output by the clock sensors. So even though the clocks are called sensors, they are really just kind of player buttons, buttons that the player can push to make stuff happen immediately without waiting for a duplicate or specified conditions to happen. So I love these things. They basically serve as manual overrides. So I have three clocks serving as manual overrides for safety mechanisms, but if I wanted to, I could just let everything run naturally and it should all happen without me being involved. Okay. So the four sensors that I cannot control very well are the hydro sensor, which detects the presence and pressure of water here, the atmo sensor, which detects the presence and pressure of gas, in this case steam, inside the room, and currently there's nothing in this room. I've taken the time to turn it into a vacuum, so there's no gas in here right now. And these two gas pipe element sensors, which are both set to look for steam, and I'll explain more about what they do in a few minutes. So those are my four sensors. The general high-level function of what these do is the hydro sensor tells the liquid shutoff when to send more water into the room. The atmo sensor tells the gas pump when it should send steam up to the rocket. And the combined outputs of the gas pipe element sensors tell the gas pump when to stop sending steam to the rocket. So it sounds pretty simple. Looking at it is kind of a nightmare, but the concept is pretty simple. The hydro sensor tells the liquid shutoff when to take water out of this liquid reservoir and dump it into the room to be boiled. Atmo sensor tells the gas pump when to send the steam, and the steam, or the gas pipe element sensors, tell the gas pump when to stop sending steam. It's all very simple. Simple concept, just slightly chaotic implementation. Okay, so let's dive in. Now, when I unpause the game, probably the first thing you're going to notice is the steady changing of stuff over here. These four circuit boards together constitute a flip-flop circuit, and they are running kind of in their own little isolated pocket of the circuitry all by themselves. They're not really changing any output because I'm not letting them change any output. I'm currently using this clock sensor to serve as a manual override to prevent the output of this flip-flop circuit from affecting anything else in the machinery. But the question may be, why do I have a flip-flop circuit in the first place? The reason for that is because when I was first getting into rockets, or steam rockets, and oxygen included a couple of years ago, I had no clue how to boil water. I didn't even know that that's what the liquid tepidizer was capable of. I didn't know the liquid tepidizer could boil water. And the advice at the time from a couple of years ago, which is now probably obsolete, was that it was very difficult to boil water using the tepidizer. And one of the things you should do was try to trick the tepidizer into applying heat into its surrounding water more quickly than was programmed. And the way you tricked it into doing that was by quickly turning the tepidizer on and off and on and off and on and off repeatedly at very short intervals. And the way you accomplish that rapid turning on and turning off without waiting for a duplicate to hike out from the middle of nowhere and come up here and flip a switch manually, the way you did it was with automation, and specifically these four circuit boards. So we have an AND gate on the front end, a NOT gate on the back end, and a filter and buffer gate in the middle. Now, all four of these circuit boards are required, but the middle two can be in either order. Currently, I have a filter gate on the left and a buffer gate on the right, but it doesn't matter. I could have those two swapped. It doesn't matter where these are positioned in the middle, as long as you have them both being in the middle. Okay. So the AND gate takes a couple of inputs, and as long as the inputs say the same thing, the AND gate will output a given signal. Preferably, in order to make the flip-flop circuit work, we want the AND gate's output to be a green signal. And when that green signal is received by the filter gate, it does its usual countdown. Hang on, let me just tick time back around until we come back. Da-da-da-da-da. There we go. So the AND gate just started outputting a green, and the filter is like, whoa, 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 hold your horses, I'm not ready to output a green. You have to wait for me to count down. I have 5 seconds on my clock, you gotta wait for, mister. So the filter gate starts counting down, meanwhile it's continuing to output a red, which flows through the buffer gate, flows through the NOT gate, and comes out as a green signal. And so currently it's holding green, it's holding a green output for 5 seconds. Once the filter gate cycles through, it sends a green signal to the buffer gate, and the buffer gate instantly outputs a green, which becomes a red gate on the back end of the NOT gate. So now it's outputting a red signal for 5 seconds while the buffer gate counts down. And then it oscillates back to green. And then oscillates back to red. So it's doing red and green for 5 seconds each every time the flip-flop circuit oscillates. So we can do stuff with this output, with this 5 second oscillating output. We can do stuff with that. And the thing I'm trying to do is send its counterpart signal into the AND gate, and every time my override is turned on, let me just turn it on for a second. So now the manual override is sending out green, and as soon as we get a green into this AND gate, the AND gate will output a green to the tepidizer itself, and the tepidizer will start turning active. So currently it says disabled by automation grid, but as soon as we get a green coming out of this lower NOT gate into the AND gate will output a green signal from this dot, and the liquid tepidizer will be turned on for 5 seconds. Watch the countdowns. There we go. Oh, tepidizer's on. It's doing stuff. It's producing heat. And, oh, it's off again. Wait another 5 seconds and it turns back on. So that is the function of the flip-flop, is to trick the tepidizer into turning on and off rather frequently. Now, like I kind of whispered into the microphone a few minutes ago, this is probably all obsolete information. I have no idea if it is even necessary to have a flip-flop circuit anymore. But because I'm too lazy to experiment and see if it is necessary or not, I just build it anyway because I feel like continuing to do it out of a sake of tradition. So there you go. There's a flip-flop circuit. You can use it for whatever you want to. Currently, I'm using it for a tepidizer, but you can use it for whatever you want to. You can change the intervals to be much longer than 5 seconds if you want to. Do whatever you want with this, but that is how you set up a flip-flop. Now, the final piece of the flip-flop is to feed back to itself. So, the output from the NOT gate on the back end of the flip-flop, it is combined to send its signal back to the AND gate, and that constitutes one of the inputs on the front end AND gate. The other input is something that most people will use as a manual control. They'll put another clock on here and they'll just turn the clock on from this end. Excuse me. But I have chosen to make the flip-flop much more automated, and the way I'm making it more automated is by relying on additional signals from the two sensors that are in the steam production room. Okay, so let me talk about those, how these two sensors, the Atmos sensor and the Hydro sensor, how those are working together to tell the flip-flop when to turn on the tepidizer in order to boil the water to make steam. Let me spend a couple of minutes talking about these two guys and how they're working together. So, I guess I'll start with the Hydro sensor because it's a little bit simpler. The Hydro sensor communicates first to this AND gate, which is sending its output to the liquid shutoff. So that is the thing that the Hydro sensor is directly controlling, is the shutoff. And I have one of my manual safeties here to override this if I so choose, in case for some reason we are completely out of water or I don't want to put any more water into the room. Like right now we actually have way too much water in here, so honestly I should probably turn that off. but anyway, so the Hydro sensor tells the liquid shutoff when it should be sending more water or when it should postpone sending any more water. And in addition to that, it also diverts the same signal into this OR gate. Okay, so there's one of the two inputs for the OR gate coming from the Hydro sensor. The other input is coming from the Atmos sensor. So let's trace that back. It goes through a couple of automation wire bridge jumps. There's another jump, and there's the Atmos sensor. So the Atmos sensor is most directly telling the gas pump when it should be on or off. But additionally, it is sending a signal over a couple of jumps here to get into the second input of the OR gate, And these two sensors combined, the hydro sensor going into input B and the atmo sensor going into input A of the OR gate, cause a certain signal to be sent out of the OR gate. Now, why did I use an OR gate? The reason is the special conditions under which an OR gate sends out a given signal. The OR gate outputs a red signal when neither input A or input B are receiving green. So currently everything is at rest. The hydro sensor is saying, whoa, I have way too much water. Do not turn on the liquid shut off. There's way too much water in here already. I have plenty of water. Do not send me any more water. So it is outputting a red to the OR gate. And the atmo sensor is saying, whoa, there's nothing in here. We're sitting in vacuum conditions, man. We have nothing in here to pump. Do not turn on the gas pump. So it is sending a red signal as well. And so when both of these signals from the hydro sensor and the atmo sensor are saying red, that is when the OR gate outputs a red. That is the only condition in which the OR gate outputs a red. The AND gate can output a red signal if either sensor is sending a red, which is not what I want. And the NOR gate can output a red signal even if both sensors are sending a green, which is definitely not what I want. So the reason I chose an OR gate is the specific conditions in which it will send a red output signal. Outputs a red signal when neither input A nor input B are receiving green. So that is exactly and only when I want a red signal to be output back to the flip-flop. Okay? Now, of course, when the hydro sensor is saying, I have too much water, and when the atmo sensor is saying, I have insufficient steam, those are the conditions in which I want to start producing steam. And that is when I want the tepidizer to be turned on so it can start boiling water and producing steam. In order to make the tepidizer turn on, I need to give the flip-flops AND gate a green signal. So to translate the red output of the OR gate into a green signal that could be interpreted by the flip-flop AND gate, I have to run the red signal through a NOT gate and reverse the signal. That is the function of the NOT gate. It outputs the exact opposite of whatever it receives. So red from the atmo sensor and red from the hydro sensor combine into the OR gate, sends in a red signal out. Red gets translated by the NOT gate to become a green for the flip-flop, and the whole cycle is allowed to commence. So we can begin boiling water. Go. There we go. And we are boiling water. Okay. Now, the only circuit board I haven't talked about yet is the memory toggle. And the memory toggle is the emergency shutoff for shutting down the gas pump. Okay. Currently, it is outputting a green signal, which is saying it is okay for the gas pump to turn on as soon as the atmo sensor detects pressure. So the memory toggle is saying, feel free to output, or feel free to start sending steam whenever you are ready to send steam. So it is continuously outputting green until I change something. The only way the memory toggle will start outputting a red signal is if it receives a green input to its reset port. So if a green signal comes down from the emergency detection and says, whoa, we have way too much steam, stop sending in steam, the green signal will come in, the green signal will hit the reset port and force the memory toggle to output a green, or output a red signal, which will get combined inside this AND gate and instantly shut off the gas pump. So that is the function of the memory toggle. It's basically an emergency shutoff whenever it receives a green signal from above. Now, what causes that green signal to be sent? Well, that comes from our steam detection system. I took the liberty of branching the steam pipe into a couple of parallel branches here. And what you'll see when the steam starts moving through it is the way oxygen not included works is whenever it sees a fork in the road, it will send every odd numbered fork in one direction, or every odd numbered parcel of material in one direction and every even numbered material parcel in the other direction. I like to call them bubbles, so we'll call them steam bubbles because it's easier to say. So every odd bubble of steam will go in one direction, every even bubble of steam will go in the other direction, etc., etc. Now the way this works is they just happen to flow through these two middle tiles where I have the gas pipe element sensors. I have both of them positioned at the same spacing and the two branches of the pipes. So the two bubbles of steam will just happen to pass through each sensor at the exact same time, which can be advantageous if you have it set up this way. Originally, I'll just make a quick confession. Originally, I was expecting the bubbles to flow through each sensor at different times, and I was kind of relying on that, and so I was using a buffer gate instead of a filter gate, but I'll explain why the current setup works just as well, but it's kind of necessary to be set up this way. So because the bubbles just happen to flow through here, let me just let time run, okay? Hopefully get some steam out of this. As the two bubbles of steam pass through these sensors at the exact same time, the sensors will both send green signals at the same time, and they will hit the OR gate, and I'll explain why it's an OR gate in a minute. They'll both hit the gate, and the gate will send a combined signal back through. Now, I do not want to send a green signal back down until I need the gas pump to shut off. Remember, this is an emergency shutoff. I do not want a green signal to come down to the memory toggle port until I am ready to have the gas pump quickly and immediately shut off. Okay, so I do not want a green signal out. Now, remember what the filter gate does. There we go. We have steam flowing. Hey, we have steam flowing. Cool. Remember what the filter gate does. The filter gate maintains the output of a red signal until its elapsed time. In this case, I'm going with the default 5 seconds. Doesn't really need to be that long. It could be a bit shorter, but whatever, 5 seconds is fine. It will not output a green signal until the 5 seconds has elapsed. And in order to do that, it needs to continuously receive a green input from this gate down here. It needs to continuously receive a green input for 5 seconds before the filter gate will even think about putting or about sending a green signal back down to this circuit. Okay, so that is why the filter gate is so important. If I had a buffer gate, that would be the exact opposite behavior, and it would cause catastrophic failures. I would always be turning off the gas pump because the buffer gate instantaneously sends a green as soon as it receives a green, and it will maintain sending a green even when it begins to receive a red signal. It will maintain sending a green for 5 seconds by default. So the buffer gate is the exact opposite of what I want. I needed to use a filter gate because it maintains a red output. Okay, so now let's slow down time and actually watch the steam going through. So there's bubbles moving through at the same time, and notice they move through intermittently past the pipe sensors. Okay, so now let's watch the behavior. Currently the sensors are sending red because there are no bubbles coming through. Nope, bubbles are coming through. We're sending greens. We're both getting to the OR gate. And we have green going here. And the filter gate is like, whoa, 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 hold your horses. I'm not ready to send green yet. I need to count down my red timer. And oh, the steam bubbles are gone. Hey, I can reset my timer. Here comes a new bubble. Whoa, I need to count down. Oh, I can reset. Oh, I can start counting down. Oh, I can reset. Oh, I can start counting down. Oh, I can reset. Oh, I can start counting down. Oh, I can reset. Okay, so you get the idea. It never sends a green signal until these pipes get backed up with steam, until they are flooded with steam. And when they become flooded with steam, that is when the whole entire system is supposed to recognize that the fuel tank is full. And when the fuel tank is full, we do not need to be sending any more steam. So the filter gate can send a green signal down here to the memory toggle, the reset port specifically, and the memory toggle will output a red signal and shut down the gas pump. That is the function of this steam detection circuit. Now finally, why did I choose an OR gate? Well, I chose an OR gate because, as you're probably going to see in a few moments, the steam frequently cools down and breaks the pipes. And the pipes frequently get broken. It frequently obstructs the flow of steam. If the steam flow, or if a pipe is broken in just one of these two parallel pathways, then it will force the steam to flow continuously through the still functional pathway. And by having a continuous stream of steam coming through, the sensor will be sending a green signal continuously. And when the OR gate detects a green signal in either side, it will continuously output a green. And by continuing to output a green signal, the filter gate will count down all the way, and it will then start outputting a green back down to the memory toggle, and it will do an emergency shutoff of the gas pump. So basically, the OR gate, by being able to send a green output from having a single green input, whether it's from the upper branch or the lower branch, that is one of the ways it can detect that the pipes are broken and it needs to shut off the gas pump so we stop wasting steam and allow repair crews to come up here and repair the pipes. So that is specifically why I'm using an OR gate right here. And that, I believe, is all of the automation. All right, so let me run through it one more time very quickly. Everything starts with the sensors. We have atmos sensor, hydro sensor, and the two gas pipe element sensors, and three clocks to serve as manual overrides. Actually, this one is a manual override, this one's a manual override, and this one is a manual restart of the system, but we'll hopefully get to see that in action later. So, the sensors say when more water needs to be pumped, and or the hydro sensor says when water needs to be pumped into the room, or when it needs to stop being pumped into the room. The atmos sensor says when the gas pump needs to start sending steam, or when it needs to stop sending steam, and the two sensors combined get funneled through this OR gate to tell the flip-flop circuit when it should be active in order to make the tepidizer work, in order to start boiling water and producing steam. And then the steam detection circuit says when the pump needs to shut off because either the tank is full or we have some broken pipes. There you go. That is it. The only thing I haven't explained yet is this reset clock, but hopefully we'll get to see that in action later. And about this little blinking red exclamation point, don't worry about that. That's just because this little wire bridge shouldn't be here. It claims that there's an invalid port overlap. That's what the signal's saying, invalid port overlap. But to be perfectly honest, there are no overlapping ports. It's just that the game does not like seeing any kind of port sitting on top of another gate. This port belongs to the wire bridge itself. There is no port on the AND gate in this specific tile. So there is no actual port overlap. It's just that it doesn't like having an automation port sitting on a gate. So it's complaining unnecessarily. You could call it a bug if you want to. It's totally meaningless. All right, let me check on chat, and then we'll fill up the steam tank and go for a launch. All right, nobody's commenting, nobody's watching. That's fine. Let's kick this into high gear. All right, steam is flowing through. Blink, 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 blink. Notice the flip-flop has turned off. It's no longer flipping and flopping because the atmos sensor is saying, well, we have steam in here. There's no reason to continue making more steam. We have plenty of steam to pump. Please stop making more steam. And actually, what is the pressure here? We are sitting at 116,000. Oh, now we're down to 115,000 grams per square tile, whereas the detection cutoff range is 2,000 grams. So we're going to be sitting here pumping steam for quite a while. All right, we'll sit here and watch this and keep an eye on the tank. The tank's now up to 717 kilograms. Let's see if that's enough to get us a launch. Oh, it is! It is! It is! We can launch right now. Cool. All right. In that case, let me do a quick emergency cutoff by swapping the conditions of a green signal from the atmos sensor to be if the pressure in the room is below 2,000 grams. So that'll be a quick sort of cheaty way of halting the gas pump. There we go. All right, and now we can launch. All right, so I guess we didn't get to see what the reset button does, but basically it's a necessary function of how the memory toggle works. If the memory toggle were to receive a green signal into its reset, if it were to receive a green signal into its reset port, it would force the memory toggle to output a red. And the only way to get the memory toggle circuit board right here to once again output a green signal is to send a green signal into its set port. So let's take a look at that. so you can see it a bit better. Actually, let me do it up in space where I can draw the sandbox tool, so it'll be easier to see. Okay, so memory toggle is currently sitting like this in my base. All right, and so has a couple of things like this. Actually, I'll draw it like it's actually sitting. So it's doing this and it's doing this, and we'll destroy that one because we don't need it. All right. And we have a long line coming down from the steam detection system. And let me just simulate that with a little clock and another clock. And there we go. Okay. So, there we go. So that is how it sits right now, I believe. Yes. Red on top, green in, and green out. Okay. So when it receives... when the memory toggle receives a green input from the steam detection system, it will change its output to become red, like so. Boom. Now its output is red. Now the only way to get it to stop being a red output is to input a green system, or a green signal, which is why that clock is on. So, red output, green output. Basically, whenever the steam detection system shuts off, it is allowed to turn the signal back on because I have this clock system over here acting as a reset system, basically. If I were to turn the clock off and input a green from the steam detection system, it would continue to output red even when the steam detection is no longer active. So by having the clock be on, it basically allows the system, or the memory toggle, to be reset after the steam detection system quiets down. Okay, so that is what that is all about. Don't need that anymore. All right, and let's launch the rocket. Oh, we're still running. Oh, I forgot to pause. Okay, let's launch the rocket. We're going to open up the doors and... oh, hang on. I need to get somebody in there first. AstroDrift, go. Destination is selected. We have fuel to reach it. We're all set. AstroDrift, go. And I believe that is set to priority 8, so she should come soonish. Let's see if we can go follow her. AstroTurf. Follow cam. Oh, she's putting her suit on right now. Yeah! Whoa, that was dizzy. Whee! Alright. And she's in. Okay. So now we have everything set up. We are ready to launch. Let's open the doors and retract the gantry. Gantry's gone, doors are opening, we gotta wait for everything to fall down. And we actually have quite a bit of gold amalgam already collected. We're over 1,000 kilograms just from meteors falling down. The gold amalgam is literally falling into our lap right now. And I think here comes some more. Yeah, it's digging it all out. Now we don't actually have to wait for this to finish digging, we can launch right now, and I'll just instantaneously collapse all the material here, which is what I'm gonna do. However, I do want to pay special attention to my circuit boards, because last time I was using lead automation wires instead of iron automation wires in some of these places, and the exhaust from the rocket engine kind of dipped into this room and melted a few of my wires. So I want to make sure it doesn't do that again this time. All right, so let's launch to our destination. We've been here once before, and we're going to go again right now. Alright, we'll slow this down, go to automation, and there goes the rocket. Boom! All the material is collapsed and the rocket is taking... oh, I should probably put a sound for this. Ah, it's not very loud anyway. Oh, yep, it burned a couple of my wires. No, it burned some wires! Dang it. Well, that's okay. Small price to pay. There goes the rocket! Whee! Alright. Cool. And there's all the super hot steam. Condensing on all of my drywall. Oh, yeah, I did put some temp shift plates into this room to try to help spread some of the heat around more evenly. Alright, let's get some of these things repaired. but I'll do that on my own time. That's basically the episode. There we go. So steam function, or steam rocket filling, is pretty well automated. In future episodes, I hope to have these scanners working so they can automatically launch the rockets and automatically open or shut bunker doors as needed. But for now, I'm just doing it manually. But that is pretty much everything set for the circuit boards. And that is the episode. So, thanks everybody who came and watched this. If you're watching a recording of this, please let me know if you have any questions about what you just saw here. I can try to explain in some comments or some screenshots or whatever. And if you want to get in touch with me more directly, you can try to reach me on my Discord server. So, yeah, I'll catch you guys in the future. Stay tuned. Have a good one.